why we must stop hailing politicians. A politician builds a makeshift wooden bridge across a wide gutter and invites dignitaries to a fanfare to commission the contraption. Proudly erects a signboard there with his name boldly on it, splashes pictures on social media. I am not subbing anyone, honestly. We applaud, we hail the politician, because we remember suddenly that there has not been a project like this in the area for 50 years. This is a first, we say conveniently, forgetting that this is the year 2021. The former students of a public school put funds together to build a toilet for the school. They invite the commissioner or permanent secretary of the Ministry of Education in the state to commission it. The government official shows up proudly to cut the tape of a toilet in a school that they are paid by us to run, but that has now ended up having a basic but compulsory facility such as a toilet built by private citizens. The people who pay for the toilet hail the commissioner for taking time out of their busy schedule to attend. I have concluded that there is something seriously wrong with the Nigerian public office holder. But the disease is not half as bad as that which is plaguing the Nigerian people. Yes, the suffering masses. We complain about how hard and bad things are on a daily basis. Yet, when the time comes to take a stand, we are the chorus leaders and the applause commanders. We just love it. It's almost as if it is part of some custom or tradition to show gratitude to ineffective public office holders. It is as if we disagree. The public officials owe us, and by us, I mean their bosses. Yes, we are the bosses. The citizens' value for our money. These people actually all swore to an oath, one they disregard almost on a per second basis. Our politicians in Nigeria are some of the highest paid in the world, and I mean legally and illegally. Yet, when they embezzle billions of naira and give us substandard roads, bridges, and other infrastructure, captains of industry and traditional leaders will line up to sing their praises. Now, let me take you somewhere else, to the UK, where the UK government spent an estimated £500 billion just to support UK citizens during the COVID-19 pandemic. Nobody clapped for UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson. In fact, all they have done is question his methods, policies, and preparedness. Boris Johnson rides in a two-car convoy. Nobody clapped for that. He sometimes goes to work or about his duties in public transport. Nobody claps. Roads are built and commissioned without fanfare, no foundation laying ceremony or groundbreaking. Nobody claps. Now imagine this was Nigeria. One would begin to think the people who live in these countries are absolutely heartless or ungrateful. But there is a simple reason they don't clap. It is because there is no reason to clap. Public servants are servants after all. In fact, I see them more as paid slaves. They are being funded by taxpayers' funds to serve their masters, the people. So why should the masters clap for their servants when they do a job they are handsomely compensated to do? Not to talk of them drooling over the most mundane achievements. A governor awards the construction of a 6-kilometer road to a contractor who is his friend or crony. At an exorbitant value, the contractor does a shabby job, but by the grace of God, God with small letters, just manages to complete the project. The governor and the contractor share the profits, but the masses who get a badly built road are the ones who organize praise and worship sessions for the governor for building a footpath where an expressway should be. Nigeria is still way off the mark in terms of development And this is not by accident. Public hospitals and schools are an eyesore, institutions of deep shame, I call them. This hailing of public officials has to stop today.
Absolutely.
Well, I don't even know what to say. I don't know why.
Let's take a minute to take it.
Yes, I know. Exactly. Why was the commissioner there to cut ribbon for toilets?
Our mentality.
There's no need for you to be
why
there.
Why did we invite him?
Yes, someone invited him. For toilet or for cutting of ribbon for a window at a local government office.
Or a wooden bridge.
Or the wooden bridge.
So I think it's a fundamental problem. You know, is that we don't understand the meaning of the word service.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
or if servant.
You know, I don't say servant. You know, if you say servant, they won't show up.
So let's go.
If you say public servant, they won't show up.
Or public service.
You know, service. Mm-hmm. The word service is derived from the word serve. And to serve means to be the servant, which brings you back to the word servant, right? If we understood that fundamentally, that this person is here to serve me, you know, then it changes the game. Instantly. But you see, for us, it's more of a game of, you know, I'm here to help you. It's that thing we're talking about, the Mizar complex. Yes. So I've built a road.
Exactly.
I have a right to put a billboard and then say, road constructed by. Sir, it's what you're paid to do. By the way, it's public service. Even if you're not paid enough, that's the whole point.
But I think it goes back to why people go into politics. It's not to serve.
Mm-hmm.
It's not to serve. Because they know that the structurally is made to go and make money. That's where you go and make your money, you go and make your name. You're not there to serve. Mm-hmm. You're not there to do good. You're there to enrich yourself and your cronies. Mm-hmm. So we also need to understand that is actually the lay of the land. It's great to say, oh, we're meant to be public servants, public service, but let's look at the reality on ground. Mm-hmm. That's not how it's looked and perceived as.
Yeah.
Right? General public perceives it as His Excellency. Her Excellency. Mm. Excellency of what? I really despise having to say His Excellency. What have you done that is excellent?
Yes.
I mean,
what is excellent about
you? Okay, you go ahead.
I want to say that if you go to some local governments where young youth corps members serve, you hear about some youth corps members who build bridges using their own allowance. As in, they use their 23,500. I don't know what they're paid now, but they use something that's little to build bridges, to offer community. Free medical care. So you're wondering, so why
and
do we have
and
leaders?
There's a local government chairman in
exactly.
that state, and there's a governor in that state, and there's a councillor in that
exactly.
state. And those people earn, you know,
and more money.
But you see, why I want to look at it from this angle. You see, we're talking about the government. Or the politicians. Let's leave the politicians alone. Why? Now let's look at this. An average Nigerian now, you go to a shop by the roadside to buy something. The woman is there busy talking on phone. And he's telling you, I'm busy, just wait. Mm-hmm. And there are other shops there. And you see a Nigerian there waiting for the woman to finish talking.
Yes.
The question I always ask is, why won't you just move on to the next shop? Mm-hmm. Let her know that if you're not serving me well, I will move to another person.
Yes.
I have an option.
Service, that's word
it.
Service.
So
yes.
what I'm saying in essence is that is what we bring into politics. Mm-hmm. You see, we've been so battered over the years that we've lost our sense of demanding for our rights.
Absolutely.
So now we just take anything goes.
Yeah.
We are like a man that gives somebody money. Okay, hold this for me. When I need it, I'll come for it. Mm-hmm. Then you go there and says, oh, your money, I've kept it somewhere, but I can loan you money. Then you keep taking a loan,
on your own
and
money.
There's interest and there's interest. Whereas this guy is keeping your money for you.
Is that thing? You know that syndrome? What's that syndrome where people...
Stockholm syndrome.
Mm. You know, I use this example all the time. Is you know, let's say you're married to a man that is an abuser, right? And he just abuses you emotionally, physically, and then never comes home. You know, the day he comes home at 7 p.m., you say, ah.
Thank God.
Or comes at midnight, you say, thank God, ah, he even came home
he
today.
Came,
or,
he tried.
Ah, you call your friends and he came today. Is that Stockholm syndrome? Is that we've been so battered, we don't even understand. We don't even know what our rights are.
And
someone builds a road, we heal them. Why?
The word
that's the job.
And it's even so sad that you see some commissioner saying the governor is so ready to work. Excuse me,
our
sir, that's why we voted him there. Yeah, tell me he's ready to work. So, I mean,
but this
he cares about you. Hello.
This applauding, not even of mediocrity. I think, Babasola, you've been very kind.
Yeah.
the applauding of everything substantive.
Yeah.
As long as it's finished, or even it doesn't even need to finish.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's so many uncompleted elephants projects.
It's not about the person that came in and didn't do anything.
So we're so apathetic as a population. That's for them, if nobody's holding them accountable, why should they bother to hold themselves accountable?
That's it.
You know,
the interesting thing, the interesting thing is I don't think anybody even measures politicians' performance against their promises.
No.
Anymore. People will just kind of like wait for the guy to show up in your community, erect a borehole, commission it, you go there, you clap, you say, ah, the governor has tried. We never had a borehole in my community. You don't say he promised us X, Y, and Z, and he's only done A. You know, and that is not good enough. Yeah. I think I always use my uncle as an example when he was chairman of the Lagos State Health Management Board, that he not only refurbished hospitals, but he insisted that anyone, any member of his family, including his wife who was Irish, had to use those same public hospitals. He said, because how can I tell the public to use a hospital that my family are not using? I've got to show that confidence. You know, and it's that kind of service that is missing in Nigeria, when people are ready to put themselves and show that, look, I've done this bit of work and I have confidence that it works.
Well, I think that's a massive, massive point. And we could go all day on it.
The injustice of Nigeria's justice system is next with Oluwa Kayode. Stay with us.